Have you ever noticed in popular movies how they make God the villain? Why would they do that?
Find out on this episode of LED Live.
Hey everybody, welcome back to LED Live. Today is gonna be a little bit different of a show. We're gonna give you a little throwback to the very beginning of this ministry. We get a lot of questions where people comment on when we point out that the villain in the story is really a representation of God and the hero in the story a lot of times is a representation of the devil. And they're kind of taking the stories and concepts of the Bible and they're flipping them upside down. So this actually came from a presentation called Hollywood's Gnostic Gospels. As you will see, we've run around and given presentations in churches over the years. This is actually one of those presentations that we were giving, but it lays that foundation of the why are they doing this? Where is this coming from? And so we're gonna discuss about four different films. Maybe some of you guys have seen these. One of them is The Matrix, one of them is Pleasantville, one of them is 300, and one of them is The Truman Show. So these are actually films that we saw this pattern way back, and it's kind of one of the things that started this ministry and the trajectory that we actually ended up going in. And so it's kind of neat to get to look back and see where this is all started from, and you get a little window into our thought process as we analyze some of these movies. If we look at Genesis 3, 1 through 5, this is the story of the Garden of Eden, okay? In the Garden of Eden, when Eve was talking to the serpent, this is where this is taking place. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said unto the serpent, well, we may eat of every fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit that is of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God had said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day that ye eat thereof, that your eyes will be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Did you know that in these two verses right here, Lucifer, or Satan, as he was called, has opened up the doors to every system of false religion that is out there in these two sentences. You see, the first one is that ye shall not surely die. That's the basis of spiritualism, the immortal soul, that you will last forever, you will not surely die. And like here in the movie Ghost, it's dealing with these types of spiritualistic ideas, the immortal soul. Then your eyes shall be opened, the basis of Eastern religion, that you will have knowledge and gain more and more of this enlightenment, which will bring you to higher and higher levels of existence. You have that you shall be like gods, the New Age, that you actually have God inside of you, that you are somehow equal to God. Like in the movies here, these people are worshipped as gods. They have this mentality that they are God. You can see that in the music industry. In fact, a lot of the people, Jay-Z, I don't know if you've ever heard of him. Jay, he has a song called Hova, H to the Izzo, V to the Izze, and his name is Jay. He's saying that he is Jehovah. And people that are signed underneath them, they have God complexes. Knowing good and evil. The mixture of good and evil is the basis of paganism. That if there needs to be an equal balance between good and evil. You see that? But what was the main thing that Satan was trying to get Eve to do? To basically question God. That is the basis of Greek philosophy. The beginning of wisdom is found in doubting, and by doubting, you come to the question, quoted by Aristotle. So question everything. We are here today, brothers and sisters, because we took that question to question everything. And isn't that kind of what the struggle and the fight is over? God says, listen, I've got 10 things for you guys to do. And yet we still question him constantly. And in fact, here, the basis of wisdom is not to question. The basis of wisdom is to fear the Lord. That is the beginning of knowledge. For fools despise wisdom and instruction. Solomon wrote this in Proverbs 1:7. But this word here in the center, knowing, is the word I want to focus on tonight. A mystical, esoteric knowledge known as Gnosticism. Gnosticism sprung out of the second century, and it was a group of Christians who broke away from the church, and they started to teach things that were known as inverted hermeneutics. They took the Bible stories, and they started to flip all the characters upside down. They took the stories of God, and they said, well, actually, God's not a good God. God's kind of the evil God. And all of a sudden, they take the Satan character, and they say, Satan's not such a bad guy. He's not evil. He's actually a good guy. This is actually what Gnostics believe. Gnostics believe there's a transcendent, unknowing being called the true Father, i.e., kind of like God, God the Father, or a living Father. And he created the god Sophia. This god Sophia was separated from the true Father because it was forbidden to know him. And she became angry and had a type of an abortion, and she created a god called Yaldabaoth. Now, Yaldabaoth is Yahweh. This is who the Jewish writings write about, the God that we all believe is this God in the Bible. And the Gnostics teach that he was the one that was cast out of the cosmos and confined to the physical universe in which he created. Now, who created the universe? Christ. Was Christ the one that was cast out of heaven? No. So you start to see how it's inverted. The hermeneutics are flipping things upside down. They believe that he is a twisted and cruel God and that he created the material world to be evil. Sophia was the one that channeled the serpent to give the human race knowledge. Hence the word gnosis is where they get that. The word Gnostic comes from the word gnosis, saying that you have divinity in you. And if you can just get to a place of high enough knowledge, you will realize that you are gods. So, Gnosticism is actually saying that this god Sophia that possessed the snake in the Garden of Eden, which was Lucifer, is actually the good guy, because they wanted to teach us that it was God that was the evil God, and he's the one that confined us into this world. Now, has anybody heard of the Gospels of Judas? Anybody? Yes, this was a very popular thing that kind of sprung up the last couple of years. They found all these writings of the Gospel of Judas, and you start to hear now that, you know what? Judas actually wasn't really the bad guy. Christ was the one that was in cahoots with Judas. And he actually told Judas, hey, betray me. So you start to see the inverted hermeneutics of Gnosticism. This the Gospel of Judas is stemming from Gnostics. There's also the Gospels of Thomas that were written.
It questions the way Jesus died and what's been considered gospel for nearly 2,000 years. Was Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples with Jesus in his final days, really a traitor, or was he the favorite disciple given a secret as part of a divine plan?
The Gospel of Judas is a real surprise. It pictures Judas not as the worst villain in the history of the world, as he's always been thought of in Christian tradition, but as the one disciple whom Jesus entrusts with secret understanding.
Basically, she's saying that, look, Judas was a good guy, not like we all believe that he was.
Some of the early Christians are now called Gnostics, or the people who know.
The Gnostics were mystics. That is to say, they were people that felt they could have some kind of direct access to God. The word Gnostic comes from the Greek word gnosis,
which means knowledge. But this kind of knowledge is not everyday knowledge. It is not book learning. It is insight. It is intuition. It is that ability to know something about yourself, to know that you have a spark of the divine inside of you, and to recognize the God that you profess to be, the God that is outside, is the same as that spark of the divine that is within you.
Isn't that the same thing that we were being told in the Garden of Eden? That you are the gods. You have these gods inside of you. And these were teachings that were taught way back, right after Christ's whole mission in the second century. These kind of philosophies have started to pop up. And let me tell you, they have not gone away.
The Gnostics also preached that the body was a prison for the divine spirit within. To them, Jesus' death was a good thing. In fact, that's one reason experts think the Gospel of Judas was written by Gnostics.
Well, the Gospel of Judas turns Judas's act of betrayal into an act of obedience. The sacrifice of Jesus' body of flesh, in fact, becomes saving. And so for that reason, Judas emerges as the champion, and he ends up being envied and even cursed and resented by the other disciples.
Judas wasn't the only Bible character the Gnostics saw differently.
The Gnostics were convinced that the serpent in the Garden of Eden was a good figure. In fact, the Gnostics turned the story of the Garden of Eden upside down, because the serpent was a rather engaging character. After all, the serpent said to Eve, "Take some of the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." And to Gnostics, that sounded like a wonderful invitation. Wouldn't you like to have a bite of an apple of knowledge and have all the juice of knowledge in your being?
They believe that the world that was created around us is actually here to control us. And that if we can just get this knowledge, we will find our way back out to freedom and to eventually become the free enough person that you all will become gods. How many people out here have seen the movie The Matrix or even know what it is? Wow, a lot of people out there, because this is a perfect example of Gnosticism.
I went to the Warner Brothers lot in Burbank to meet Andy and Larry Wachowski, the writers and directors of a film entitled The Matrix. I was excited to speak with them. They had written something that I had never seen, but in a way, something that I'd always hoped for, you know, as an actor, as a fan of science fiction. The script that they wrote synthesized to me, I don't know, it had Gibson. I'm gonna be a little inside baseball here, as they say. But it had Gibson, it had Verne, it had Kay Dick, Frank Miller, anime, Kurosawa, Peckinpah. It was Nietzsche. It was Buddha. It was Christ. It was mythology, philosophy, technology, and truth. What truth?
So even here he's admitting it's Philip K. Dick. Philip K. Dick was very much so into Gnosticism. It's Nietzsche. It's all these other philosophies mixed together. It's Christ. It's Buddha. Let me ask you a question. Here he's saying it's truth. Can you mix a ton of air with truth? And what happens to the truth? So they're putting this idea into everybody's head that the Matrix is truth. And did you know that The Matrix is the number one most analyzed and watched movie by Christians on the face of the planet? This was a highly, highly, highly talked about movie from the pulpit. I've heard sermons preached where we should be like Neo and this and that and all fighting for freedom. But I want to show you something, how they take this story of heaven and earth and God and Satan, and they flip it upside down on its back. And then they start to take the character that they are portraying as their God, but it's actually the Antichrist. Larry and Andy Wachowski, these are the two guys that actually wrote it. Larry here now thinks he's a girl. He's actually, I think, changed himself into a woman. I don't know if that, take that for whatever it's worth. It's interesting. But here's what they said. When asked how they came up with the idea for The Matrix, they replied, designer drugs. Well, if anybody out there has experimented or knows much about drugs, you are opening yourself up to a world beyond what we can even understand. What I want to point out here is here they're saying he has two lives. He has two different names. What is his name?
As you can see, we've had our eye on you for some time now, Mr. Anderson. It seems that you've been living two lives. In one life, you're Thomas A. Anderson, program writer for a respectable software company. The other life is lived in computers, where you go by the hacker alias Neo and are guilty of virtually every computer crime we have a law for.
Thomas Anderson, his computer hacker name is Neo. These names, Ander comes from the Greek word andros, and it means man. And Neo is Greek for new. So here we have the new son of man. You see that? They pick these names to actually really have these double meanings, and they're now starting to say, here, this person is like Christ. For who is the Son of Man? Jesus Christ. For the Son of Man is come to seek and save that which is lost. Luke 19:10. So when asked how they chose the names for the characters, they replied, they were all chosen very carefully, and all of them have multiple meanings.
Hallelujah. You're my Savior, man. My own personal Jesus Christ.
Here they're alluding to, you're my Savior, man. You're my own personal Jesus Christ.
So, can I ask you something? Did he tell you why he did it? Why you're here? Jesus! What a mind job. So you're here to save the world.
They're just putting these kind of slight thoughts into your head that he is equal to Jesus Christ. This is my now this scene here
Nebuchadnezzar
is where he comes into the ship for the first time.
This is the main deck. This is the core.
The camera pans on this plaque here that says the Nebuchadnezzar. Now, who was Nebuchadnezzar? The king of Babylon. So this ought to make everybody's lights go cling on right here. Notice at the top it says what? Mark, number, Mark 3, number 11. Does anybody know what Mark 3, number 11 says in their Bibles? Here's what it says. And in the unclean spirits, when they saw him, fell down and cried, Thou art the Son of God. Even in the end of the movies, in the end of the series, he even has a scene where he dies like Jesus Christ. But let me show you, which Jesus Christ is this?
Did you sleep? You go tonight. I guarantee it. I'm Tank. I'll be your operator.
You don't have any holes?
No. Me and my brother Dozer were both 100% pure, old-fashioned, homegrown human, born free right here. In the real world, genuine child of Zion. If the war was over tomorrow, Zion's where the party would be.
It's a city.
The last human city. The only place we have left.
Where is it?
Deep underground, near the Earth's core where it's still warm.
So here's Zion. Where is Zion? Zion is heaven, right? Is Zion in the center of the earth, near the earth's core, where it's still warm? Who here wants to stay here and go to that Zion? John 8:23. And he said unto them, Ye are from beneath, for I am from above. Ye are of this world, but I am not of this world. You can start to tell these philosophies when in these movies they fight for freedom constantly, and what are they fighting for? Fighting for this place, the glorification of earth. This is our earth. This is our dirt. Brothers and sisters, I don't want to be here. I hope this thing ends soon. I am just a stranger on this planet now. This is their Zion. Does this look like heaven to anybody? This is the center of earth where they said the last human city will just party. Looks a little bit more like the hot place to me. When asked which Matrix scenes were they most happy with, which was your favorite? And here's what Larry Wachowski answered. If you're talking about the pill scene, that was our favorite too. Oh yeah, here's another shot of him as a girl. Just thought that was kind of funny.
Do you believe in fate, Neo?
No.
Why not?
Because I don't like the idea that I'm not in control of my life.
I know exactly what you mean.
Pause. Who doesn't like anyone else to control them?
The Matrix.
It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
Anybody see any similarities to the very first story that I told you? In Genesis, who came down to us and put it in our minds that you are living a lie, you are living in a fake controlled world, you are a slave. Why don't you free yourself? Take the apple, eat it, Eve. And did you notice the pills? What did he say right when he said it, when he handed it to her? All I'm offering you is what? The truth and nothing more. And which pill did he take? Which color? Red. Imagery is everything. This is the Wachowskis' favorite scene. Why? It's because it's the pinnacle point that made us fall. This is the taking of the apple scene in the whole movie. So from here on out, you start to see which Jesus Christ is he really claiming to be.
I know that you're afraid. You're afraid of us. You're afraid of change. I don't know the future. I didn't come here to tell you how this is going to end. I came here to tell you how it's going to begin. I'm going to hang up this phone, and then I'm going to show these people what you don't want them to see. I'm going to show them a world without you. A world without rules and controls, without borders or boundaries. A world where anything is possible. Where we go from there is a choice I leave to you.
So this is in the very end of the movie here, when he's basically telling the Matrix, I am now going to show them a world where there is no rules, there is no boundaries, where anything is possible. And I'm going to show them a world without you. And what does he do? He walks out of the booth, and he steps up into the sky, and he ascends into the sky, just like Jesus Christ ascended after his resurrection. And if you remember, right before this, he was shot, killed, and resurrected. So, who is claiming to be God? And who wants to show us a world with no rules, with no laws, and no boundaries? And this is the protagonist of the story. So what they do is every single person that has no idea what they're doing, and you were to ask who's the good guy and who's the bad guy in this movie, they would all be like, oh, we want Neo to win. So they trick you into psychologically wanting that character to win, and therefore they're playing with your allegiance. In fact, the three guys that they're fighting against, they're called agents, right? And they all dress alike, and they all speak each other's words.
Never send a human to do a machine's job.
If indeed the Insider has failed, they'll sever the connection as soon as possible, unless...
They're dead, in either case.
We have no choice but to continue as planned. Deploy the Sentinels.
Three of them? Interesting. Who are they fighting against? The Godhead? And the Matrix, this controlled environment, they take it, they flip it upside down. Joshua 22:5 says, but take diligent heed to do the commandments and the law, which Moses, the servant of the Lord, charged you, to love the Lord your God, and to walk in all his ways, and to keep his commandments, and to cleave unto him, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul. The law is constantly under attack. Just like what we talked about with Superman the other day, for those of you that were here. Superman fighting against Lex Luthor. Lex is Latin for law. They are fighting against this law. The mentality that we have, the postmodernism mentality of, hey, whatever's right for you is right for you. Do whatever you want to do. Do whatever makes you feel good. Don't do what God told you to do. He gave us very specific things to do. When asked if they, the Wachowski brothers, were aware of the Gnostic theme of the Matrix, this is what they replied. Do you consider that to be a good thing? I would. They weren't even denying it, that it was chock full of Gnostic themes. The Truman Show, also another highly, highly Gnostic film.
30 years ago, the Omnicam Corporation created the ultimate reality-based television experience.
The Truman Show.
Beginning with the child's birth, they set out to document an entire human life, every single moment, broadcast live to the world. They created his hometown of Sea Haven.
All of it completely enclosed within the dome of the Truman Stage.
Cue the sun.
And even though The Truman Show has become an international phenomenon, Truman himself has never learned the true nature of the world around him.
Truman! It's television! Yes!
Despite some close calls, every aspect of his life has been carefully scripted and meticulously crafted. But the one thing no one could predict was who Truman Burbank would grow up to be.
Good morning!
Morning!
Oh, and in case I don't see you, good afternoon, good evening, and good night.
There is an environment that was created, that there is a person that is actually controlling the sun, every aspect of this person's life, okay? And Truman is this main star that everybody else is watching. Let me bring that a little closer to home. We live on a planet that God created, that we are the ones that are justifying God's name, and the rest of the planets around the universe are all watching what's going on here, because what goes on here is what's justifying God's name. God is vindicating his name through the characteristics of his people, his church, and through sending Jesus Christ, who lived as us and lived and walked amongst us and lived a perfect life, told the rest of the world out there, hey, God's way really is right. So here's a movie that's very similar experiences on a much smaller global level in our world. So here's the players. The actual guy that created the show, his name is Christoph, or maybe Christoph. And guess what his partner's name is? Moses. Interesting. Truman is actually a play on words, true man. So Truman is representing the human race. His wife is the woman that the creator gave him, the Eve character. The woman that actually informs Truman that, hey, you're living in a fake environment, you're living in a controlled world, is Silva, the informant. Sylvia, this is the member back in Gnosticism. Sophia, the woman that was created, that possessed the snake and gave them knowledge. So here they've got all the characters. Oh yeah, and his father. His father was the guy who loves him, right? Loves him so much that they actually kicked him off the show. And he comes back onto the show to try to tell Truman that he loves him. And what does he come back as? He comes back as a homeless person, a bum. Did you know that our father came here as a person without a pillow to put his head? And here they've got all the characters of this story. So let me show you how this plays out.
Morning, Truman.
Morning, Spencer.
Hey, Pluto. Oh,
no.
Oh, get down.
He won't hurt you.
Get down.
Yeah, I know. It's just me.
Come on, Pluto.
What does that say on the light? This is why you have to pay attention to everything that's put in a movie. Every single thing that is in that frame is put there for a reason. Does anybody know what Sirius is? Sirius ninth canis. Sirius is the brightest star in this ninth canis major. It was worshipped by the Egyptians. It was worshipped. In fact, if you look at most ancient civilizations, they had some form of worship of Sirius. And in the occult world, Sirius is worshipped as Lucifer. So I find it really, really, really fascinating that here in this story, the way that he finds out that he's living in a controlled environment is from a falling star from the sky that is worshipped as Lucifer. So, moving along. Oh yeah, Sirius was also known as the Dog Star. In fact, you know the Sirius company, the radio, satellite radio? It actually has a picture of a dog with a star in his eye. That's where it comes from. And here's the part where Sylvia is actually gonna let him know that, you know, it's all fake, it's all for you. And this is just reconfirming the story of the serpent in the Garden of Eden.
They're here. Truman.
What do they want?
Listen to me. Everybody knows about it. Everybody knows everything you do. They're pretending, Truman. Do you understand? Everybody's pretending.
Lauren, I don't know.
No. My name's not Lauren. It's Sylvia. My name's Sylvia.
Sylvia?
Yeah.
Lauren, sweetheart. Not again.
Hey, wait a minute. Who are you?
I'm her father.
What?
I've never even
Come
seen
on,
you
sweetheart.
Before.
We're doing it.
Please, honey.
He's lying.
Honey, please.
Truman, please.
No,
don't listen
no.
to him. Hey, everything I've told you is the truth.
Please.
It's fake. It's all for you.
I don't understand.
And the sky and the
what?
Sea, everything. It's a set.
I don't
it's a show. Everybody's
You'll be
watching
all right.
you. Please, don't
please,
listen to him.
Lauren.
He's going to lie to you. Watching
What's
this
going
right
on?
Now.
I really would like to know what's going on.
She has
please.
Episodes.
Schiz- what?
Oh, no.
We tried everything. Hypnotism, everything.
No, don't listen
Shock
to him,
therapy.
Truman.
Don't worry. Don't
Truman.
Worry. You're not the first. You're not the first.
Truman.
She brings all her boyfriends oh. down here.
What's he saying? Truman, he's lying. Get out of here. Come on, find
Don't
me.
Worry. We're going
I'll
to
see
Fiji.
You in school.
Fiji. We're moving to
there
Fiji.
No
Fiji?
See the similarities? She even says, no, that's not my name. Always known to have many different names. They're all pretending. It's all fake. Totally confusing him. Telling him, get out of here. You don't want to be in this sea haven, this paradise that was created for you. So this next scene that I'm going to show you is him actually getting in the boat and wanting to leave. And listen to the way that they are portraying the creator, Christoph. and think about what I told you about Gnosticism, how they all teach that God is actually an evil creator God, and he's just this mean guy. Think about it. That's exactly what Lucifer told Eve in the Garden of Eden and everybody else that he made fall. God is too, he's just too hard. Why don't we go to a place that we can do whatever we want? So pay attention to the way that they portray Christoph.
How do we stop him? Okay.
We're going to be accessing the weather program now. So hold on to your hats.
There's no risk you body wouldn't know what to do.
He'll turn back. He'll be too afraid.
There she blows.
Give me some light. Again. Hit him again.
The whole world is watching. We can't let him die in front of a live audience.
He was born in front of a live audience.
You can do it! Hold on! Is that the best you can do? You're gonna have to kill me!
What you will do with a drunken sailor? What you will do with a drunken sailor? Keep running.
Increase the wind.
Increase the wind! I am telling you from the last how close is.
Very close.
Capsize. Tip him over.
God, his tide is up to the bow.
Shut up!
He's gonna drown. He doesn't even care.
Do it!
So you see how they portray God as this insensitive, doesn't care about your well-being. He's just up there controlling the environments. Hit him again with some lightning. Now, here's where I'm going to show you something else. In the background, where they put things, you know, they use a lot of biblical numbers in stories. If you guys ever see a movie and there's just some random number, pull out your Bible and try to find something that pertains to that number. And let me show you exactly in this next scene when he's pulling up the sailboat. Look at the number on the top of the sailboat. So if you go to Psalms 139, it says, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting and my uprising. Thou understandest my thought from afar off. Thou compassest my path when I'm lying down, and thou art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, that thou knowest it altogether. And the whole entire psalm is talking about how God is above, and he knows everything that we do. And here in this scene, this person, Christoph, knows everything that he does, everything that he says, everything that he's going to do. In the very end of the movie, he continues to go on to get away from this environment, this control that he is, and watch as he comes to the end of the environment, the conversation and the dialogue between him and Christoph.
Thank you.
What does it look like he's doing? And you know, in the occult world, there's always a ladder to get to a higher state of knowledge. And here he's going to climb the ladder to leave his existence in God's created world.
I want to talk to him.
Hope and joy and inspiration to millions.
Then who am I?
You're the star.
Was nothing real?
You were real. That's what made you so good to watch. Listen to me, Truth. There's no more truth out there than there is in the world I created for you. Same lies. The same deceit.
Same lies, same deceit that's out there is the same lies and the same deceit that's in here. I don't think there's lies and deceits in God's world.
I've been watching you your whole life. I was watching when you were born. I was watching when you took your first step. I watched you on your first day of school. The episode when you lost your first tooth. You can't leave, Truman.
Please, God.
You belong here. Talk to me. Say something.
Say something. You're on television. You're live to the whole world.
In case I don't see you. Good afternoon, good evening, and good night.
Yeah.
Where is he going to step into? That's watching him is so excited that he left God backwards. Do you know that there is a whole world out there of people that are sitting here watching us, cannot wait for us to get home, that we can be with them? Not that we're going to leave God's world. This is 100% inverted hermeneutics, and it's just slamming God. There was a writer that wrote a movie called The Island of Dr. Moreau. His name is Richard Stanley, and he says, I guess one could see the whole mass media as it stands today as some sort of extension of Gnostic faith. Maybe cinema itself is acting as some kind of hand in the apocalypse. Interesting, somebody that is involved in the industry would say, yeah, maybe it is, has a part in this whole end time thing. Pleasantville is another movie that is hugely Gnostic and celebrating humanism and flipping things upside down and on its back.
There's a place where life is simple. People are perfect. And everything is black and white.
Honey, I'm home.
It's a place that's as far from reality as we can imagine.
How about some marshmallow rice squares?
Those are swell.
But maybe it's a lot closer.
Let me see that.
Than we think.
What happened?
I'm not sure.
Look at me. I'm pasty.
Morning, kids. Better get a move on or you'll be late for school.
I put blueberries in them just the way you like.
We're in Pleasantville?
No!
We're supposed to be in school.
We're supposed to be in color?
What's all the commotion?
Who's that?
I didn't think you'd want to come here until we've been pinned for a little while.
You can pin me anytime you want to. Or maybe I should just pin you.
She's a fine young woman. She would never do anything for us to be concerned about.
From the creator of Big and Dave.
What are you doing to these people? You can't do this to them. You're messing with their whole universe.
Maybe it needs to be messed with, David.
Comes a story about the loss of innocence.
I brought you something from the library.
Gee whiz.
And the power of change.
What's outside of Pleasantville? There's some places where the road keeps going. Shouldn't cover that up.
What is that?
What's going on? It's rain. Honey, I'm home.
New Line Cinema presents.
Look at my face.
It'll go away.
I don't want it to go away.
Something is happening to our town.
Jeff Daniels, William H. Macy, Joan Allen, Reese Witherspoon, and Tobey Maguire.
So what's going to happen now?
I don't know.
Pleasantville.
What are we going to do, Bob?
Well, we're safe for now. Thank goodness we're in a bowling alley.
So once again, a perfect environment. And here, in this perfect environment, somebody comes into the perfect environment and starts to taint things a little bit. And notice, it's kind of black and white, and it's kind of boring. Have you ever asked somebody who doesn't even believe in God, would you like to go to heaven? Have you ever asked that question to somebody that just doesn't believe in God? Ask it. Here's a piece of homework for you. Go home and find somebody who absolutely does not believe in God and watch this response. Why would I want to go to heaven? That would be boring to do the same thing over and over and over again for an eternity. And you know where we get this idea that heaven is boring, black and white? Hey, maybe introducing a little bit of sin and color into the world would be much more exciting. So, in this movie, remember that scene where she was up there on the thing, and she said, oh, you know, like, we could make out, or well, that was their word for make out, I'm assuming, or maybe even more than that. And here, he had never even seen that before, and so she takes him and makes out with him, and all of a sudden, when he is driving home, this is the first time that he's actually sinned or done something out of the ordinary. And he starts to see a little bit of color in the world.
Look at him.
Now everybody is going up to this mountain and making out, and more people are starting to turn colors because they're doing these out of wedlock things. And
somebody ought to do something about that.
In fact, now, here these two characters are going to go up to this place where all the kids are making out, and they're going to go make out for the first time, and here is their experience.
TV, the sounds of Pleasantville.
Here's a new one for all you kids out in Lover's Lane.
At last,
You know, doesn't Satan always make sin look good? I often wonder, what did that fruit look like on that tree? Was it just this just beaming, amazing things? Because if it didn't look as good as the tree of life, why would she ever have walked by it? Satan has this incredible ability to put goggles over our eyes, to make us think that the grass is greener on the other side. If we just had this, we would be happy. If we just had that. But I always like to equate it to the health thing. Everybody likes pizza and ice cream, right? Go eat a bunch of pizza and ice cream your whole life and see how it makes you feel. Go eat a bunch of fruits and vegetables and see how it makes you feel. Sin is always going to look good, taste good right off the bat. But down the road, the effects get worse and worse.
Do you want some berries?
Huh?
Some berries I picked them myself.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's lots of stuff.
Like what?
Here, I'll show you. Here.
I think I've seen this scene before.
Wow! Whoa. There's the red apple coming in.
What is that? What's going on?
It's rain.
Real rain?
Yeah. You don't have rain either? Oh, of course you don't. It's okay. Here, come on. What's going on? It's rain. It's okay. It's fine. There's nothing to be scared of. Here, I'll show you. It's just rain. It's okay. It's fine. Come on out. You see? Look. You see? Come on. Come on.
You know what I always think about when I see that scene? Do you think all the people that were standing outside of Noah's Ark? Rain, it's just a little rain! And then what happens? Symbolism in the movies is what drives them. So when you start to see these kind of things and these ideas that are starting to be pushed out there, what is that doing to what we believe? It's just a little sin. We can handle this, right? Come on, we've made it this far. We can figure out some way to make this whole thing work.
I didn't do anything wrong.
Oh, no? Let me show you something.
Go on, try it.
Boom! Right there! What do you call that, huh?
You know, you don't deserve this place. You don't deserve to live in this paradise. Where's the remote control I gave you?
Why?
Because you're coming home, you little twerp. And I'm going to put this place back the way it was.
Once again, how are they portraying God? As this angry, cynical person. And that he's just there to control you and this and that. These are thoughts and things that they constantly are throwing at us. The mother here, she actually left her husband, and she cheated on her husband with the guy that owns the soda shop. That's how she turned color. So every time somebody actually sins in the movie, they start to turn color, okay? So the guy that owns the soda shop, what he does is he paints a mural on the side of his soda shop of her completely naked. And nobody's ever seen a naked picture before. So all of a sudden, these boys see her walking down the street, and now they want to harass her, and you'll see.
Hey, where are you going in such a hurry? Now, that's not real friendly.
Yeah, see, she looks like a picture.
Yeah, you want to be friendly, don't you?
Yeah, come on. Let's show us what's under that nice blue dress.
Yeah, come on! Hey, where are you going? There's nowhere to go over there.
You know, that is a lovely shade of blue. Don't you think that's a lovely shade of blue?
Get
okay? What?
Oh, I'm so happy you sinned. Just kills me. And I saw this movie when it actually first came out, and of course I didn't see any of this. And it wasn't until I came back into the church and started reading my Bible that I started opening my eyes, going, what are these people trying to tell me? So, here we start to see that because of the violence is why he changed color. And I find it interesting that it wasn't because he ate the apple. Once again, maybe eating the apple would resonate with Christians too much if he changed color. But maybe if they just waited a little bit, maybe you wouldn't catch it. So the next scene that I'm going to show you is when they're actually in a town meeting, because all these people are now starting to change color. And now the town's in an upheaval, and like, what do we do now? We have all this mixture of people that are colorful and people that are not. So they're holding a town meeting, a judgment meeting. What to do with the town or the race of people that are now colorful.
I know you want it to stay pleasant around here, but there are so many things that are so much better, like silly or sexy, dangerous, or brief.
Silly, sexy, dangerous, grief. That's better than pleasant.
Doesn't she look pretty like that? Doesn't she look just as beautiful as the first time you met her? You really want her back the way she was? Doesn't she look wonderful? Now, don't you wish you could tell her that?
You're out of order.
Why am I out of order?
Because I'm not going to let you turn this courtroom into a circus.
Well, I don't think it's a circus, and I don't think they do either.
This behavior must
stop at once. But see, that's just the point. It can't stop at once because it's in you, and you can't stop something that's inside you.
It is not inside me.
Oh, sure it is.
No, it is not.
What do you want to do to me right now?
Come on.
Everyone is turning colors. Kids are making out in the street.
No one is getting their dinner. Hell, you could have a flood any minute. Pretty soon, the women could be going off to work.
While the men stayed at home and cooked.
That is not going to happen.
But it could happen!
No! It could not!
Bud.
What if Satan would have gotten Christ to fall when he tempted him? What would he have done? He would have pulled out a mirror and he said, you're just like me. You're colorful just like me. And here, the judge, the God character, judge, he's judging everybody. And he's sitting there saying, you're just like us. You're just like us. You have it inside of you and you can't stop this. And that's the same thing that Satan is trying to tell everybody, that it's inside of you. This is something that you cannot stop, God. And that's why we're still here.
Hey, look at this.
They get you going, they get the music, and they're like, yeah, you know, this is what it should be like. Once again, flipping the story of the Garden of Eden upside down. There was a movie that came out not too long ago called 300. And this movie was extremely popular with the youth age. And everybody was like, oh, this movie's so awesome because it's a real story. It's about real, like, events where these 300 Spartan people actually fought off these thousands of Persian armies and everything. And you know, it was this horrible, gory movie. Once again, I want to show you how they take the story of heaven and hell, God and Satan, and they flip it upside down. And they take the lead character, the character of the Spartans, and they actually as the protagonist, I want to show you how he is the Luciferian character and they make him the hero. Leonidas and Artaxerxes. Actually, you know Artaxerxes is in the Bible. You know that? He was a good guy. Artaxerxes was hugely responsible for actually rebuilding Jerusalem and rebuilding the temple. So I find it kind of interesting that they picked this Artaxerxes, and there's many different Artaxerxes, and there's many different Cyruses who he was the son of. And tonight we dine in hell, says Leonidas, and a god king must die. Do you know that God was called the King of Kings, Lord of Lords? And did you know that in this movie, this king, Artaxerxes, was called the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Hosts of Hosts? They portray Artaxerxes as this really, really rich king who ordained himself with gold and everything. And all Artaxerxes wants from Leonidas is for Leonidas to bow down and worship him.
Let me guess. You must be Xerxes.
Come, Leonidas. Let us reason together.
Have you heard that before? Isaiah 1:18. Come now. And let us reason together, saith the Lord.
You have many slaves, Xerxes, but few warriors. It won't be long before they fear my spears more than your whips. It's not the lash they fear. It is my divine power, the time of generous God. I can make you rich beyond all measure. I will make a warlord of all Greece. You will carry my belt standard to the heart of Europa. Your Athenian rivals. We'll kneel at your feet. If you will but kneel at mine.
You are generous, as you are divine. King of kings. Such an offer only a madman would refuse. But the idea of kneeling, slaughtering all those men of yours has left a nasty crack in my leg, so kneeling will be hard for me.
So here is somebody who doesn't want to bow down and worship him. Here is them fighting together. I find it really interesting that the people that are fighting on Artaxerxes' sides are called the immortals. Well, who do we know that fight with God that are known as immortals? People that live forever, angels. And so here they're fighting against him, and just listen to what they say about Artaxerxes.
Immortals. They fail our king's test. And a man who fancies himself a god feels a very human chill crawl up his spine.
A man that fancies himself a god, that is called the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Host of Hosts. Who are they taking a stab at? Who feels a very big chill, human chill, up his spine. So here, this scene right here is Leonidas talking to one of the people that is his own. And listen to what the guy says. They're just about ready for the very last battle. And so the guy's going to talk about he lost his son. And so Leonidas here is telling him, I'm sorry that you lost your son. And listen to what the guy says to him.
I have lived my entire life without regret until now.
My heart is broken for your loss.
Heart? I have filled my heart
filled my heart with hate. Good. You know how many kids watch these movies and idolize every single word that comes out of these people's mouths? And this is the hero, the protagonist, the person that they're voting for to win. And these thoughts and things are just being put into people's minds. Now there's a little hunchback character that enters into the scene, and all he wants to do is fight for the Spartans in this war. And he actually, Leonidas turns him down because he's a hunchback and he's not perfect and everything, and sends him away.
I beg you, bold king, to permit me to redeem my father's name by serving you in combat.
I am sorry, my friend, but not all of us were made to be soldiers.
So the hunchback now goes to Artaxerxes and gives them the location of where they are and everything like this. And so he's actually going to, like, help out the other side.
Embrace me as her king and as her god. Your joys will be endless. You will find I am kind. Unlike the cruel Leonidas who demanded that you stand. I require only that you kneel.
So, our God is asking us for our worship. And here they're just tainting it and twisting it and turning it and everything and making the bad guy our God. Here's the very last scene.
His shield is heavy.
Your spear?
You there, Ephialtes. May you live forever.
May you live forever for choosing that side. Once again, another reference that he will be part of the immortals. So in this scene right here, Artaxerxes is going to win. And all he wants is Leonidas to bow down and worship him. So this is what's happening. Now I want you guys to pull deep within your biblical knowledge and think about what scene is this going on in our Earth's history. I want to show you something. In Philippians 2, verse 10 and 11, that the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, and the things of heaven, and the things of earth, and the things under earth, that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is our Lord to the glory of the Father. Did you know that in the end of this whole mess that we're in right now, Satan himself will bow the knee and say, God, you were right. Every single tongue will say, I was the one that was wrong. You were the one that was right. And then what does Satan do? Revelation 20. And then Satan, when the 1,000 years are up, Satan will be loosed out of his prison. And they shall go to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, and gather them together to battle, the number of whom this is the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and encompassed around the camp of the saints about. In that beloved city, the fire came down from the God of heaven and devoured them. The final scene is Satan getting up from saying, God, you are right, fighting once more with everybody, and then fire comes down and consumes them. And that's what they're telling people. But yet, who do you think? People watch these kind of movies and go, I want to be like that. I want to be on that side. And the whole rest of the movie, if you finish out, they're saying, like, you know, we want this spirit to live on in everybody. And then the last scene is them going to war with somebody else, and they're going on with the same spirit that Leonidas has. I want to close this out with looking at the stories in the Old Testament. Why did the Israelites miss Christ the first time? Why? If you study Exodus 12, and they were given the Passover and everything that had to do with the coming of Christ the first time, they were given specific instructions. Kill the lamb in the evening. Have your staff in your hand and your girdle. And have all these things. And eat it in haste. Eat it together. There was specific things for them to do. Put the blood that's on the doorpost. What if some of those Israelites would not have put the blood on the doorpost? What if they would have done everything but not the blood on the doorpost? They would have lost their lives, right? And so they had for thousands of years done these things that God or Christ himself had asked his people to do so that when they would see Christ come, they would recognize him. And John the Baptist stood there himself and said, behold, the Lamb of God. Everybody that was in an earshot of that knew exactly what they were saying. And yet they still missed him. You see, the devil is not stupid. The second we try to underestimate him and the second that I constantly hear people who watch our presentation and they go, oh, but you can find God in anything. You can find the good in anything. Let me ask you, these people are mixing good with bad. They're mixing truth with error. And there is only one way. There is only the truth, the way, and the life, the name of Jesus Christ, that we can even have salvation. There is not other ways. And that doesn't mean that, you know, somebody that doesn't know who God is, don't misunderstand me for that. There would be lots of people in heaven that will be like, Christ? Who's Christ? Holes in your hand? What are those? I have no doubt of that. But we have no excuse. Do you know that people in today's day and age have more access of information at their fingertips in one day than a person in the early 1900s had in their entire lifetime? There is nobody that's going to get to the gates of heaven at our age and our day and say, oh, sorry, God, I didn't know. They're manipulating your views of God. They're changing. If you watch Transformers, like Brandon showed earlier and everything, there's a war coming. They're putting all these thoughts and these things out there, and they're trying to get you to pick a side. They're fighting just as hard as we are. They have much flashier tools and much flashier play toys than we do. I mean, who listens to just a preacher anymore? Now preachers all have, you know, PowerPoint, this and that. They got to, you know, somewhat entertain people. Because nobody wants to sit there and listen to somebody just talk. So what I'm trying to say is study your Bibles. If you study the truth, you will be able to spot this stuff as an error. And in fact, my knowledge of films and everything like this, I was so obsessed and so in love with them, I'm having a harder and harder time talking about them because I don't watch them. I know what they're doing. And so if you study and gain a relationship with God, these things will grow strangely dim. And I honestly believe that they will turn sour in your mouths just like they turn sour in our mouths. So take a lesson from the Israelites and learn who Christ is. This is an attack on Jesus Christ. A lot of these movies are constantly attacking who Christ was, who God is. Why? Because if they mess up who God is, what is Satan's very last deception that he's going to do? Impersonate Christ. So if they mess up who you think Christ is, and they constantly you know, give you all these false ways, the Supermans, the Batmans, and then all of a sudden Satan steps on the scene as Christ, and somebody goes, hey, look, there he is over there. And people don't recognize him and know who he is and know what they're looking for, just like the Jewish nation did not know who their Christ was and what his mission was. We will all miss the boat too. So know that they're trying to mess with you, and I just pray that you guys will just dive deeply into your Bibles. So we hope you guys got a blessing out of watching that presentation. Thank you guys so much for watching and sharing our content. Thank you, Patreon donors, for keeping the lights on in our ministry and donating and seeing the value of our work. As always, like, subscribe. If you guys are new to this channel, definitely check out some of our other videos. We've got a lot of merch. If you guys like t-shirts, check out some of the t-shirts on Teespring or our website, littlelightstudios.tv. If you guys want a physical copy of today's presentation, we sell all these presentations on DVD, and you can also rent a lot of our documentaries on littlelightstudios.tv. You'll get a Vimeo link from there where you can actually go ahead and rent those videos. So as always, thank you guys. We'll see you guys next Friday, and God bless.